Welcome in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to our service of worship today in All Saints. Today is our patronal festival, All Saints Day, and we commemorate all who have gone before us in the faith of Jesus Christ. And you will see around the church silhouettes giving the details of those who died in the First World War. And just two rows ahead, we remember Flight Lieutenant John Vickery. I'm sad to say that we are also commemorating somebody else who's gone before. On Tuesday early morning, Norman Caskey died. Norman was a man of great faith and hope, and he encouraged us. So that's sad news to bring to you today. Would you like now to stand for our hymn, which will be sung by the choir? Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We're invited to stand if we're able to for the gospel reading from Matthew 5, verses 1 to 12. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Now, when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. He said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Well, good morning to you all, and it's good to be with you this morning. Earlier this week, Sandra, my wife, told me that she thought I had a bad case of tartle. You all know what tartle is? No? Well, apparently it's a new word developed during the lockdown, and it's the complaint where you forget someone's name the very moment you need it. And I was suffering from the tartle. There's another new word as well, which I also suffer from time to time, which is called snack accident. And you can imagine what that is. Accidental devouring of snacks so that you get to the end of a biscuit packet before you realise you've started. The truth is that sometimes we are better at forgetting than we are at remembering. And there are other things that we, and times when we remember things, when we should forget them. And November is very much a month for remembering. So this afternoon, at the beginning of November, we will remember those who have gone before us, and we will commemorate their lives in a memorial service. You're welcome to join us for that at 4 o'clock. Then next week, a week later, Remembrance Sunday. And that gives us an opportunity to remember those who gave their lives to preserve our freedoms. The many whose lives were shattered by injury and loss. And members of our armed forces who protect us today. Again, the theme is very much of remembering. And this year we will be remembering specifically the 75th anniversaries of VE Day and VJ Day, and the 80th anniversary of the Battle of Britain. And then, of course, between those two events, there will be great fireworks displays and bonfires as we remember the gunpowder plot, 1605, and the attempt by Guy Fawkes and others to assassinate King James I. And then later in the month, out will come the pumpkins, as our American friends particularly will remember the arrival and the first harvest of the Pilgrim Fathers in the early 1620s. And then very shortly after that, the retail world, if it's allowed to, will remember Black Friday. We will all remember, and we will rush out, or we will go onto the internet and we will get our pre-Christmas bargains. Sure, we'll remember that. And you might well ask where Jesus is in all of these remembrances. Amongst all the frenetic activity of remembering this and that and the other during November, at the very end of November, we reach the climax of the Christian liturgical year with the Feast of Christ the King, which we will celebrate. We will celebrate that on the 24th, I think. But today is All Saints' Day, and our reading describes the Beatitudes, and we're quite familiar with that reading, and we've had various series in the past on the Beatitudes, and I'm not going to begin a new one today. But few of us match up to the ideals expressed in the Beatitudes, do we? We remember today all the saints who have gone before us. I wonder what comes to mind when you think about saints. You maybe think about towering figures like St. Paul, or St. Francis, or St. Benedict, St. John of the Cross, whose theological reflections influence the spirituality of many, many today. Or you might think of St. Teresa of Avila, You might think of St. Cecilia. You might even think of our own St. Catherine. Recently the subject of some real interest because of the art of Artemisia that's currently showing at the National Gallery. It's highly to be recommended if you get the opportunity before the exhibition closes to see it. And in one of the very famous paintings, she depicts herself as St. Catherine the Martyr, complete indeed with instruments of torture. And then there are other saints that are really quite fascinating. I'm always fascinated by St. Vitus, the patron saint of dance, always on the fidget, always moving. And one particular saint caught my eye this year, which is St. Simeon Stylites, a fourth or fifth century saint. Apparently he spent 37 years living on top of a pillar. And then he later attached himself to the local church. And during services, he had the habit of throwing nuts at the clergy. During services as well, he would blow out the candles. And he developed a theatrical limp and did all sorts of strange things. He would run into the women's section of the baths, naked, shock them all. And on solemn fasting days, he feasted, he consumed vast amounts of beans with inevitable consequences. And his strange behaviour is actually often thought to have been an acting out of what Paul described as God choosing the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. So saints come in all sorts of shapes and sizes, and they don't all start with a capital X. We tend to have this view, don't we, of saints being mystical figures floating around in robes. And they're often depicted in stained glass windows and intricate carvings, here in tapestries and embroideries. But actually in different ways. They help us to recall stories of triumph over adversity. They help us to recall acts of glorious heroism in the battles against injustice. And they live lives of hope and goodness in the midst of a selfish world, a greedy world, a dark world. And the truth is, of course, that they are very real people. And you can bring it more up to date by describing people like St. Teresa of Calcutta, or great people who've never officially been beatified. I'm thinking of people like Thomas Merton, the journalist turned monk. Or you could think of Jackie Pollinger, ministering to the poor and disadvantaged in Hong Kong. And you could also think of people like Desmond Tutu, and of course Nelson Mandela, Martin Luther King, real people who demonstrated in their lives these very beatitudes. Great examples of inspiration and leadership, Christian virtuosity. And we can learn lessons from the way that God used them, even at times when their experiences were inauspicious, to say the least. I'm thinking of St. Ignatius of Loyola, badly disfigured in battle as a young man, a young soldier, taking a blow of a cannonball the size of a fist. And yet that meant that he would never be a heroic knight of the realm, but God used him mightily. It really is worth pondering the fact that God so often uses the most unlikely individual as channels of his grace and holiness. Now, my view, there are many, many examples of saintliness, even much closer to home and in our contemporary world. When Paul wrote letters to churches, he often began them, he would say, to the saints that are in Sanderstead. Very often he uses that formula. And of course, the people who are there The people in Sanderstedt, the people sitting here today, would rarely describe themselves as saints. You might even dismiss the idea, I'm not good enough to be a saint. But I'll go out on a limb today and suggest that actually we see examples of saintly behaviour even in this church in our current age. You ever thought, for example, about who cleans this church? We had a wedding here about 3 weeks ago. Straight after the wedding, three of our ladies came in and were cleaning away. That's unrecognised work, it's hard work, it's not very glorious work. But it's work that God honours as a demonstration of good Christian living. Who puts the altar coverings and the pulpit coverings like this every week to make sure that they're right? That's what Libby does. But she doesn't get paid for it. She doesn't do it to get praise. She does it to honour God. Who spends hours editing our services? To smooth them out, remove the glitches. That's what Tony and others do at the back there. Who works hard to put it on the internet? That's what Corrie does. And then I could mention people like the person who I met this morning who was in the church early setting the table. That was Barbara. She does that because she loves the Lord. And I can mention lots and lots of other people. I can mention people who do caring work and shopping work, like Anne Newsom, who cares for Barrow, for Paul and Jill James, who come and visit and take people to hospital and dental appointments. They probably don't count themselves as saints, but we salute them because their work is saintly. I look at the work that Lynn does, even though she's now not officially a church warden, and yet she spends hours still in this church working away. We salute those people because they exhibit these beatitudinal qualities. And I know I've missed some people out, and I'm sorry about that. But what I wanted to do is to make the point that we can all behave and live and be as saints even today. Many too who are left us, have left us in the last few months, who did saintly work in this church. Like Piers, who managed our churchyard so diligently. Like Brenda Lloyd, who carefully, for many years, did caring work at St. Edmunds. For Richard and Sue Rack, think of them, the work that they do even now today. None of these people get awards. They don't get recognition. But that's how it is with the Beatitudes. What God has called us to be. Behaviour patterns, ways of living, saintly behaviour that befits the saints that we are in Jesus Christ. Often unsung heroes, often nameless individuals, people who give but do not count the cost, people who labour but do not look for any reward. Those who are poor in spirit, who are meek, who are hungry and thirsty for righteousness, who are merciful, pure in heart, peacemakers, persecuted for righteousness' sake, reviled, persecuted, none of them are in it for a reward. And the message today and our celebration today invites us all to consider how we too might become living witnesses to the holiness and bearing the name and the light of Christ. In our baptism, we are named with the company of saints. That is our calling, seeking to be ordinary, everyday saints, making Christ known in our community, living out that message of hope and peace. Exercising forgiveness, being willing to make sacrifices for the sake of the gospel, demonstrating Christ's message of love, living as lights in a dark and uncertain world. My prayer is that God will challenge us as we live out these next few weeks seeking out ways to live as the saints we are called to be. And now the choir is going to sing to us, "Sing to the Lord your God." Sing a new song.
Selfish examples. Lord, in your mercy. Loving Lord, we thank you for your love and compassion as we walk through this challenging time affected by COVID-19 pandemic. We ask for wisdom for those who bear the load of making decisions with widespread consequences. May they be men and women of integrity, guided by a desire for public service and a love of truth. And we pray for all those who are suffering with sickness and for those caring for them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In these restricted times, we are very grateful for the variety of communication channels we have to keep in touch with each other. But we also realize that not everyone is able to access these. And we pray today for other ways for them to stay connected with family, friends, community, and their worshiping community too. We pray for our church and for the future activities planned for Advent and Christmas, that there will be times that will reach out with your love to people who perhaps do not yet know you. We pray for Chris Newman, Anne and Mike Fister, and Jeremy as they work together to produce Adventure 2020. And we also pray for Chris and his family that they will be able to relocate to Sanderstedt and to be able to continue with their work here in an easier way. Excuse me. Lord, in your mercy. Father God, make us instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, let us sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. May we not so much seek to be consoled as to console. Not so much to be understood as to understand. Not so much to be loved as to love, for it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we awake to eternal life. At this point, we remember Norman McCaskey, who has been part of our fellowship here for several years, and for anyone else known personally to you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, in the Garden of Gethsemane, you shared with everyone who has ever been afraid. You conquered fear with love and returned from death itself, saying, "Do not be afraid." In the light of your love, death has lost its sting, and so has fear. Lord, may your love be the key that releases us from suffering and fear. Keep alive in us the memory of those dear to ourselves whom you have called to yourself. And grant that every remembrance which turns our heart from things seen to things unseen may lead us always upwards to you until we come to our eternal rest. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Faithful God, we thank you for the example of all the saints. And as we go from our worship and out into the coming week, help us to follow in their footsteps with courage and hope, determined like them, to do your work and live the gospel of your Son. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen.
Shall we stand? I know we can't shake each other's hands, but at least we can express this greeting to one another. We are fellow citizens of the household of God with the saints, through Christ our Lord, who came and preached peace to those who were far off, and to those who were near. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
So let's give ourselves, each other, a nod of peace. And we remain standing while the choir sings, "Fill your hearts with joy."
Kingdom. Amen. The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right. It is our duty and our joy always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father. Almighty and eternal God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And now we give you thanks, most gracious God, surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses and glorified in the assembly of your saints. The glorious company of apostles praise you. The noble fellowship of prophets praise you. The white-robed army of martyrs praise you. We, your holy church, acclaim you. in communion with angels and archangels and with all who served you on earth and worship you now in heaven, we raise our voice to proclaim your glory, forever praising you and singing. And as we follow his example and obey his command, grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us his body and his blood. Who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Therefore, Heavenly Father, we remember his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross. We proclaim his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. We look for the coming of your kingdom, and with this bread and this cup, we make the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Lord. Jesus Christ is Lord.
Lord, by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free. You are the Saviour of the world.
Accept, through him, our great High Priest, this our sacrifice of thanks and praise, and as we eat and drink these holy gifts in the presence of your divine majesty, renew us by your Spirit. Inspire us with your love and unite us in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us.
Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours,
now and ever.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are one many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
I heard the voice of a great multitude crying, "Alleluia." The Lord our God has entered into his kingdom. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
So let us offer to Almighty God our lives as we pray. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and please be seated. Today we recognise Jerry Knight. Jerry, many of you will know, was for many years a Southwark pastoral auxiliary, and after retiring, as it were, from that in the parish, she has served in the diocese as a Southwark pastoral auxiliary, and this is coming now to an end, so we acknowledge that. And because of the pandemic, we have had to let Michael Burbage go as our assistant organist, and the stewards have a card, so if you know Michael and would like to write in a thank you card some words, please do before you leave. Thank you. We know that Boris spoke yesterday, and the main result for you and for me, as far as church is concerned, is that Sunday services are not going to happen physically. We will be holding our worship online. Funerals can go ahead under the same rules as before. So what are we to make of this? You may remember Jesus said to his disciples, this is at John 16:33, in the world you'll have trouble, but fear not, I've overcome the world. But that's not the whole story. The big story is God has the whole world in his hands, and Jesus has overcome through the cross and the resurrection. But we live in this difficult, dark time now. So at 1 John chapter 5, verse 13, the writer says, we are God's children. We have a heavenly Father who is over all, but the whole world is in the power of the evil one. You know, we're fascinated by the US election. We might be in awe of the power of China, but actually, there's something more. We live in a world that is yet to be fully redeemed. Can I challenge you? Take the service order with you and go back over and see all the references to the kingdom. We prayed, your kingdom come, which is actually a prayer, God, for your king to come. Let Jesus come again. In the very first reading that did read for us, 1 John chapter 3, we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him. Our hope is that the Lord will come. Let the cry of the church be, come, Lord, come. Judge the living and the dead. Put the whole world to rights. In the meantime, we share in God's lament for a world that has gone wrong. Hold on to Christ. Choose to be a Christian, to hold on to Christ. Read your Bibles. Pray every day. Love one another. Pick up the phone. And pray for leaders at this time who have decisions to make. Would you like to stand and receive God's blessing, the blessing of strength for this Christian journey? May God, who kindled the fire of love in the hearts of the saints, pour upon you the riches of his grace.
Amen.
May God give you joy in their fellowship and a share in their praises. Amen. May God strengthen you to follow with them in the way of holiness and to come to the full radiance of glory.
Amen.
And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
The Area Dean says this is his favourite hymn, because it says that our redemption lies in the future when Christ shall come again. So we hear the choir sing and we join in with our hearts for all the saints who from their labours rest. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. One generation shall praise your works to another.
And shall declare your power.
All your works praise you, Lord.
And your faithful servants bless you.
They make known the glory of your kingdom.
And speak of your power.
My mouth shall speak the praise of the Lord. Following God's saints in the ways of holiness and truth, go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
You might like to be seated until you're guided out to leave.